So we are live now, you can start.
Okay, so hey, good morning, Dr. Anup.
Good morning.
Yeah, so actually welcome to this Professor Anand Krishnan Colloquium. Very nice to have you. And so you, Dr. Anup, joined IITM in 2012. And he is dedicated to working on various processes related to Southern Ocean and also Arctic. Going on in several cruises, bringing out, unraveling many, you know, unknown things. We are all very curious, although we are not domain expert, but I think he will make all of us at the end of the talk. We'll have a good knowledge. So looking forward, Anup, please start. Stage is yours.
Thank you, Partha. Hello, everyone. As Partha introduced me, my name is Anup Mahajan, and I call myself an atmospheric chemist. So basically, what I do is I study the chemistry in the atmosphere. Usually, whenever people talk about atmospheric chemistry, they think about air pollution, because obviously that's an impact that people can see and feel and hear a lot about. But there's a lot of extra interesting chemistry happening across the globe. And you know, the way I think about why we need to study atmospheric chemistry is because we all do weather predictions in IITM, and the weather, everyday weather, is controlled by the physics, but the long-term climate is actually controlled by the chemistry through changes in radiative forcing because of greenhouse gases, etc. So that's one of the main reasons why we really need to understand the chemistry. And any changes in the atmospheric chemicals, that leads to changes in the radiative forcing, changes in to the types of aerosols there are, etc., etc. So clouds get impacted. So that's one of the main reasons to study it. Today, I'm going to be talking about, let me share my screen here. Hopefully everyone can see this, and let me go full screen. Is the screen visible, Patra?
Yes, please go ahead.
Oh, thank you, Bino. Okay, so today I'm supposed to be talking about reactive trace gases in the Indian Ocean, Southern Ocean, and in Antarctica. And also I want to talk a little bit about why we need to measure them. This photograph is of the SA Agulhas. This has been home to me and members of my group for the last 3-4 years. It's a very nice little ship with a lot of character. It's an old ship, but does manage to go down all the way down to coastal Antarctica, and has led to some really interesting observations in this part of the world where there is honestly very little data itself. This picture that you can see is actually of the ship taken from a helicopter with the Indian Antarctic base Bharti in the background. All of these expeditions are being run by NCPR, and IITM, we have been participating in it with certain objectives to study certain trace gases, which I'll talk about. Just a disclaimer, obviously none of this work is just being done by me. This is all collaborative efforts. I have to give recognition to the people from my group itself who have worked on these projects. Mrigankar, who is a CAT student, now is doing his PhD in IITM. He has gone to the Antarctic base 3 times to get some data. I'll show like a little bit of that data over here. Swaleha Inamdar, she is in her final year of her PhD, and she has been working on the oceanic observations itself. And I'll also show some of that here. Srivardhan Hulswar, he joined as postdoc last year, and he's been very productive, actually. He's doing some very exciting work on DMS, which again, I'll speak about. And then we did a little bit of work on Antarctic ozone, which was done by this master's student from the University of Pune. Her name is Prajakta. And unfortunately, she's got COVID now. So I really hope that she'll be well soon. But just to let you know that these people have contributed heavily to the data that I'm going to show. And of course, all the other departments from India and elsewhere that have contributed to the work are acknowledged here. The main people, of course, are NCPOR. Sorry, it should be research instead of studies over there. My apologies for that. But they have been doing all the logistics behind all these expeditions, and quite a bit of the data that they generate has helped us interpret our own data. So a big shout out to Dr. Anil Kumar, who's the head of the Ocean Sciences Group over there, and also all the members who have been a part of the expeditions in on the ships and in Antarctica itself. So let me start off with, I know lots of you are not chemists, so let me start off with something very simple. What are trace gases? We keep talking about them. It's a very simple definition. Basically, the atmosphere is mainly made up of nitrogen, oxygen, water, and argon. These are like the largest contributors to the bulk of the atmosphere. And then there are lots of other gases which are in very tiny proportions. So trace gases is any gas which is in small proportion. And besides the first four, five, all the other gases are essentially known as trace gases. The top gases are there in huge amounts, mainly because there's very little chemistry that happens in those gases. So the other ones is where the exciting chemistry happens because they are interacting with each other all the time. But not all of them are interacting directly. The interaction depends on its reactivity. And this graph over here shows the reactivity, which is basically in terms of the lifetime. So the shorter its lifetime, so towards the bottom left of the graph, the more reactive is the chemical species. And towards the top right are the low reactive species, which are things like your CFCs or your methane, etc., which are basically known as greenhouse gases because they stay in the atmosphere a long time and can affect in terms of radiation. The ones towards the bottom left or even in the middle, those are pretty exciting species because, you know, they have a lot of interesting chemistry. It's not just once they are emitted, they don't stay in the atmosphere for hundreds of years like CO2 does. These gases are continuously changing, so they affect the biogeochemistry quite a lot. They affect things like air pollution. They affect things like how other pollutants are breaking down. So there's a lot of exciting chemistry happening over there. So that's the part which we'll be focusing on. That's what reactive trace gases are. These are gases which essentially undergoes lots of reactions in the atmosphere itself. Of course, there are hundreds and thousands of these gases, but we'll be focusing on a few of them, mainly because we just have about 45 minutes for this presentation. And these gases, the reason why we have identified certain gases to measure is because they have global sources. So if a gas is very reactive but has only a small point source, it doesn't really matter in terms of the climate. It might matter for air pollution, but it doesn't matter as much for climate because it's not affecting at a global scale. But certain gases, even though they are short-lived, do matter on a global scale because their sources are global, even if their lifetimes are short. So that's why we have recognized some of these gases. And why do we go over the oceans or to Antarctica, etc., to measure these things is mainly because that's, you know, the oceans cover more than about 70% of the Earth's surface, which means that any emissions from the ocean are going to be important at a global scale itself. And this figure is from the Surface Ocean Low Atmosphere Study Program. This is an international program, and they have identified certain species that need to be understood well in order to get our climate right, mainly because these gases, once they come out from the ocean surface into the atmosphere, they undergo lots of different reactions and end up affecting things like albedo, the radiative properties, or ozone itself, like ozone in the stratosphere, which obviously has radiative impacts also. And through that, it can have climate feedbacks. So the emissions are not just constant. These are natural emissions. They depend on the ecosystems which get affected by climate, and hence there is a feedback loop. This is not like anthropogenic emissions that you can just turn off if you find it as a problem, but this is a natural phenomenon which needs to be quantified in order to get our climate predictions right. And they do matter a lot on climatic scales in terms of the radiative forcing. I'll touch upon that a little bit through my talk. So the very first one that I'm going to talk about is a gas which quite a few of you must have heard of. It's called dimethyl sulfide. It's basically what gives the ocean its smell. So every time you go to the beach, when you smell the ocean, this is basically what you're smelling. And it's basically a sulfur compound. It is the largest contributor of sulfur to the atmosphere besides anthropogenic emissions of SO2. So we know it is much larger than, you know, things like sporadic volcanic emissions, etc. This is a huge contribution, and that this basically drives a lot of the sulfur cycle in the atmosphere itself, not just atmosphere, in the biogeochemical cycle. So the reason why it got a lot of attention was because in 1987, Charlson et al., they published this really nice paper talking about the Gaia theory, or what causes the Earth to regulate itself. Their hypothesis was they knew that DMS is being produced by phytoplankton in the marine, in the seawater. This DMS gets supersaturated and gets emitted into the atmosphere, undergoes lots of different chemical breakdowns, and leads to the formation of CCN and hence clouds. Thus, it affects the albedo. Now, as the amount of DMS increases, you would have more clouds and your albedo would increase, which reduces the amount of sunlight reaching the ocean surface, and hence it's a negative feedback loop. This was a very elegant little loop that they had come up with. Unfortunately, it is not as simple as this that we know, but what is undeniable is that DMS does lead to cloud formation and leads to cloud formation on global scales. So that's one of the reasons to get this cycle right, because unless we are able to quantify this properly, we will not be able to get our climate predictions correct. In terms of getting the emissions right, which is what will help us quantify the clouds, there are basically lots of emission inventories which were there available in the literature. The latest one is about 10 years old, which is Lana et al., which was done by Rafael Simo's group in ECMA Barcelona. And what they basically did was they updated another emission inventory, which was another 10 years older. And what they saw was they saw significant differences, especially in the Antarctic, even in the Indian Ocean, etc. There were lots of differences which were noticeable. And what we did was we put this into a model. This model was run by Suvarna Fadnavis. She's at CCCR also. And we quantified this. And basically what we came up was with a number of minus 1.79 watts per square meter. Now, anybody who works on radiative forcing knows that this is a significantly large number. And this is something we need to get right if we want to get our climate projections right. Interestingly, also, it has lots of effects in the southern hemisphere as compared to the northern hemisphere. The main reason for this is because in the northern hemisphere, we have a lot of SO2 emissions from anthropogenic emissions, and hence the total effect of DMS is not as large because there's already quite a lot of sulfur. But in the southern hemisphere, especially the oceanic regions where you don't have any anthropogenic emissions, you end up having an amplified impact of DMS on radiative forcing. Basically, this is a run which was done with and without DMS, and you can see that in the southern hemisphere, you can actually get as much as minus 20 watts per square meter impact of DMS itself, which is significant. And there is a seasonal dependence on this. So this was a nice little study which we showed that, yes, this is important. We need to get it right. But then the next question was, how accurate is this number itself? So what we have started doing is we have started updating this emission inventory because it's already a decade old. And what we've done is we've included a lot of new data set. This is showing a plot of data from all over the world contributed by groups all across the world. And it is much more comprehensive than the past inventories. Significantly more data has come in over the last 10 years as compared to before. So we have now about 860,000 data points across the globe. You can still see there are pockets where there aren't enough observations. And remember, these are cruises. So these cruises are literally once a year. So that's not enough observations, but at least we have some observations in parts of the oceans where we did not before. And we are also taking into consideration a changing biology in the ocean, because the older emission inventories, the way they were created was keeping the biology fairly static in the oceans. And we know that's not very true because that depends on the seasons. So now we are taking into consideration this, and we have started creating this. Srivardhan is doing his postdoc work on this. And we've already got like an updated emission inventory right now, which is based on the observations. And that shows significant differences as compared to the past one. So now we are trying to quantify the impact of this on the atmosphere. So hopefully we'll be able to get some model runs through this. And we know that this is a lot more accurate because we've compared that to some data sets. So hopefully we are getting closer to what the real number is in terms of the impact of DMS on the atmosphere itself. But remember, this is a climatology. So basically, we do not get what is happening in terms of year-to-year changes. Recently, Marty, who was in Quebec, he basically came up with a satellite proxy-based approximation. And what we have done is now we've calculated this change in emission inventory over the years using satellite proxies, and are now putting them into the CAMCAM model to quantify whether there is a change through the years. Looking at the plot itself, which is from 98 to 2021, so we have about 20 years of data. Looking at it itself, there seems to be a small increase. I should mention over here that until 2003, it was using a different satellite for its inputs as compared to after 2003. So that big step up in 2003 that you can see, that should be taken with a pinch of salt. We are not entirely sure that that is real. I think that's more instrument-based because it was a different satellite data. But since 2003, it is exactly the same satellite proxies that we are using, and there still seems to be a cycle. There seems to be a decrease and then an increase. Whether this is significant or not is something that we'll find out soon enough once our model runs are done. But I'm very excited about this because this is going to be the very first time that anybody in the world has actually been able to quantify what is going to be the change in our climate system because of DMS over time, using actual observations rather than some parameterization based models. So this is pretty exciting work. Hopefully we should have the results for this soon. But the question is, does it matter? So the IPCC has this really interesting plot. What it shows is what is going to be the impact of species on the radiative forcing for every degree change in the atmosphere. So suppose the atmosphere increases by 1 Kelvin, the temperature increases by 1 Kelvin, then how much of a radiative forcing impact is it that's going to have because of a certain gas? And as you can see, the estimations for DMS is, it's pretty high. I mean, it's larger than the effect of aerosols in terms of the direct radiative forcing, and almost at par with the impact of change in dust because of the changes in temperature. So now we know this is going to have pretty strong impacts, and that's why we need to get it right. Remember that this has extremely low confidence because, as you can see, there's only one single study which has estimated this, again, based on a model. None of them have actually used actual observations, which now we have. So hopefully we'll be able to give a much more accurate number for the IPCC over here within the next 6 months or so. From that, I'll stop with DMS and I'll go to another exciting chemical. But what are the questions that we have left over here? The first thing is we need to get accurate fluxes to the atmosphere. There are still certain questions on the gas aerosol process level stuff, and also talking about how much changes we're going to expect in the future. Remember, with our current observations, we can say whether it is changing or not, but we can't as yet say what is driving the change. So that is something that we really need to work on, and hopefully over the next few years we'll be able to work on this. The other compound that I'm going to talk about is this group of species called halogens. Halogens are your seventh group elements, and they basically came into attention because of this plot, which is basically showing the depletion of ozone at Antarctica. And this is from the Edmondson-Scott South Pole Station. And what it shows is there was a clear decrease in the ozone as compared to what it should have been. And the main cause for this, as most of you must know, is CFCs, anthropogenically emitted CFCs, etc. But the question is, how much of this is natural? And if it is natural, is it changing? And if it is changing, is it because of climate change? So we know CFCs are causing it, but are there natural emissions of halogens which also can cause this kind of change? And the reality is that yes, because the natural halogen compounds, there is a whole bunch of them, they get emitted from the ocean surface into the atmosphere itself, and then they undergo lots of different chemical reactions. And basically, one thing to remember is they lead to ozone depletion, as you can see these catalytic cycles on both sides of the plot. But basically, ozone gets lost every time this catalysis happens, and so they cause ozone depletion on their own itself. So the question was how much of an impact it has. So in the marine boundary layer, which is the lowermost 1 kilometer, there was this really nice paper in 2008, which showed that halogen compounds can cause as much as about 45% of the total ozone loss in the marine environment itself. And this is all natural. No? We are not talking of anthropogenic emissions. So the natural cycles are causing ozone depletion. And this was pretty important. But the question was, what impact does it have all over the globe, and whether it is actually emitting, getting emitted everywhere in the world or not. So Lucy Carpenter did this really nice laboratory study where she showed that ozone deposition on the ocean surface can actually lead to the emission of iodine compounds, right? So here's a very interesting thing. You have ozone in the atmosphere. It gets deposited. It's a sticky gas. And then it undergoes reaction in the water. But it ends up emitting something back into the atmosphere, which is actually going to deplete ozone. So as ozone concentrations increase, you end up getting an increase in iodine emissions. And this increase in iodine emissions will lead to a depletion of ozone. So it's a very nice little feedback cycle over here itself. And this is something that we've really spent a lot of time over the last few years trying to quantify. One of the things we did with Alfonso's group in Spain was we put it into a model and we showed that, yes, it matters a lot in terms of its effect on the atmosphere. There's a lot of ozone loss that happens, and as much as like 25% ozone loss in the stratosphere, which is pretty significant in terms of changing the ozone layer concentration itself. And then we also tried to check whether it has impacts on the surface itself. And what we showed was, yes, about 9 to 10% of ozone loss at the surface. So at the surface, ozone is a pollutant, mainly emitted because of reactions between, mainly created because of reactions between NOx and VOCs, which are anthropogenically emitted most of the time. And so ozone concentrations are an indication of pollution on the surface, but iodine is actually helping buffer that. So if we didn't have iodine over there, we would have a lot more ozone pollution, and humans and crops, etc., would be suffering a lot more as compared to when there is iodine chemistry happening in that environment, right? And it shows that it's not just a regional thing, it's a global thing itself. And also it impacts things like NOx, OH, which is one of the main oxidants. NOx and OH together, we help them to quantify the oxidation capacity, which is basically how quickly pollutants break down in the atmosphere. So it's showing that iodine chemistry is very important in terms of changing not just the ozone concentration, so, you know, affecting air quality, but also changing in how the chemistry in the atmosphere is actually functioning. Because as you change the HOX concentrations, the chemistry itself changes completely because it is breaking things down. So this was a pretty important study. And the question was, is this changing? As I said, we think that it should change if Lucy's lab experiments are right. And then, these two really nice papers came out, which showed that over the last few years, there seems to be an increase in the iodine concentration in the ice cores. So these are ice cores in Greenland and in the Alps, and both of them show an increasing concentration of iodine in the ice cores, which basically it's like the smoking gun and indication that iodine chemistry or iodine concentrations have increased in the atmosphere. So it's pretty critical to get this right. So as I said, this feedback loop is very much there. You know, the ozone is changing how the emissions of iodine are coming out. So we wanted to make sure that this is correct first. So what we did was we have done like a few observations in the Indian Ocean and Southern Ocean to see whether that is really happening. One interesting result was it's not like a direct one-way impact. So ozone seems to increase iodine emissions. That seems undeniable. But what is also happening is as ozone increases, there tends to be more NOx in the atmosphere because it's anthropogenic. And NOx seems to buffer the impact of iodine. So as you can see in the top left plot over here, what you have is you have your ozone increasing as you come close to the coast of India. On the left-hand side is the Indian coast in terms of latitude. So as you come close to the left-hand side, you see an increase in ozone, but your iodine concentrations drop off. But up to a certain point, it seems to follow the ozone very well. It's increasing, and then boom, it suddenly comes down. What is the reason for this? The main reason is because we get an increase in NOx. So the NOx reacts with iodine and tritates it away. So you have an environment where if you have NOx and ozone, then you're not going to see a huge impact of iodine on depletion of ozone itself. But what you're actually going to see is titration of NOx itself. So putting this into models was imperative. So that's what we did. We put it into a model. This model is WarfChem, which was run by Kinyi, this colleague with whom I've worked with in the past also. And what he has basically done is introduce iodine chemistry in the model, and we have done a simple run of with and without iodine chemistry for the Indian region now. And what we see is the models do okay in terms of the IO. you know, these concentrations are pretty low. We are talking about 0.4, 0.5 ppt, so it's lower. There is slight overestimation in the model, so the parameterization, there's a question mark. I should mention that we've already reduced the parameterization by about 40% according to what Lucy had predicted. Huh? So they had come up with a parameterization, but we have actually reduced that already by 40%, and still the model is over-predicting. So there seems to be a question mark on the parameterization, which might have to be revisited. But if the model does okay, it's still over-predicting the ozone, so we might need to get it right. But it's not doing terribly bad. But when we try and see the kind of impacts it has on geographical scales, now it gets very interesting. There seems to be a pretty strong divide, seasonal cycle for sure, first of all. So January, April, July, you can see there's a big difference. And the main reason for this is going to be ozone and winds, because during January and April, as you know, the winds come from the Indian subcontinent going into the open ocean, whereas during July, being in monsoon season, the winds are actually coming from the clean environment into the Indian subcontinent. So the concentrations of ozone are much lower, and hence the emission of iodine is controlled. You can also see a geographical difference between the Arabian Sea and the Bay of Bengal. Pretty interesting plots. One thing we have said is if we do not have this emission, that this feedback emission, then we do not get anywhere close to the levels that we need. So the top panel is considering only organic iodine emissions, not considering this Lucy's parameterization. And as you can see, we are basically an order of magnitude lower than where we need to be. But the minute we include this parameterization, albeit reduced compared to what was published in the Nature Geosciences paper, we see levels which are comparable to the observations itself. So already we are showing that the parameterization is not 100% accurate. We need to improve that a little bit. And the second thing is, yes, regionally, it seems to matter a lot on the Indian subcontinent. Why does it matter? Is mainly, let's look at the ozone. So basically, the ozone concentrations, as you can see on the top panel, are, as you would say, higher in the subcontinent as compared to the open ocean, because the sources are in the subcontinent. But in the open ocean, iodine seems to have huge effects in terms of total depletion of ozone. It's reducing ozone by about 4% or so. 4 ppb, which in terms of percentage is about 25%. So just iodine chemistry, even at these very low levels, we're talking about 0.4 ppb or so, it can cause as much as like 25% depletion of ozone in the Indian subcontinent region. Now, this has pretty large implications on air quality itself, which is very, very interesting. One thing I should mention is, although it looks red in the last panel on the bottom, it is a scale issue because it's 0 to 5. It's a slab, so it's essentially close to zero. There's no difference happening at all, as you can see in this plot just below it. In terms of change in ozone, it's going to have an effect on the HOX concentrations. As I said, HOX, especially OH, is the primary oxidant in the atmosphere. So that basically controls how quickly things are going to break down in the atmosphere. So it's a very critical species to get right in your models. And as you can see, again, even for HOX, we are getting changes of about like 15% plus and minus, because of halogen chemistry. So again, we are changing the oxidizing capacity by about 15%, which is a huge number if you consider regional importance. One thing interesting is, a few of you must have noticed these lines. These are the shipping lanes. You know, the shipping lanes lead to emissions of NOx, and that changes the chemistry itself. Interestingly, halogens in the shipping lanes tend to reduce your OH concentration. So they actually reduce the oxidizing capacity when there is NOx present, as compared to places where there is not as much NOx. So this is a very interesting chemistry, which is not very linear. There are lots of different chemicals playing roles, but because of that, you get lots of like regional differences. In terms of the NOx concentrations, this is pretty important because India has very high NO2 concentrations. Obviously, the open ocean has very low as compared to it, but that leads to the formation of things like ozone, etc., in the open ocean environment. And as you can see, again, up to 50% change in NO2 is caused because of iodine chemistry in the model. Now, these are huge numbers. 50% change in NOx anywhere in the globe is going to have massive changes in your in your regional chemistry. So this is showing that in the Indian context, iodine chemistry is very, very important. All these are very hot off the press figures, and we are writing them up. In fact, we have just prepared these figures today itself. So it's very interesting to know that one single chemical which is emitted from the ocean surface can end up changing your regional chemistry completely, and being able to show that. So this is pretty exciting. Another thing that it changes, so as I said, OH is your primary oxidant, but it's your primary oxidant in the daytime. So your pollutants break down because of OH in the daytime. But at night, it is NO3, your NO3 radical, your nitrate radical, which is your primary oxidant. So again, over here also, you can see about 50% of change in NO3 in the open ocean environment. So what this basically means that iodine chemistry is changing things not just in the daytime, but in the nighttime also. So you have a full day effect of iodine chemistry in terms of how the oxidation chemistry is changing itself. So this is pretty exciting work, I think. But as I said, one of the results that has come out showing that maybe our parameterization is not correct, because we've already reduced the parameterization in the model. So the question is, how accurate is this parameterization? So on the Southern Ocean expeditions, we've been making measurements of iodine and even iodide in the seawater, et cetera, et cetera. What we tried to do was we tried to calculate the parameterization and check whether the observations in the atmosphere do match with the flux that is estimated using these parameterizations. And basically, it shows that no, it does not work. So basically, the parameterizations, the fluxes that we calculate, day-to-day fluxes, do not seem to be very accurate. Now, this, of course, is exciting in one sense, because that means there's a lot more work to be done in terms of getting our fluxes right. It's a little worrying in the other sense, because right now all the global models are using this parameterization. So, there are some question marks that we need to address in terms of the impacts because of this parameterization that's used in the model. But the good news is now we do seem to have enough data to try and redo this parameterization properly. And maybe it's time that somebody goes into the lab and recalculates these fluxes. Or in fact, if we do get a SIMS instrument, or if somebody listening to this has a SIMS instrument, it's time to get some flux observations for these species in the open ocean environment, because that's the only way we'll be able to definitely quantify what's happening. The other question is, in terms of what's happening in Antarctica, in 2007, Alfonso had published this lovely paper showing concentrations of iodine and bromine in Antarctica, and they showed very high levels, up to 20 ppt during springtime at Halley Bay in Antarctica. Since then, there are two other stations which have reported observations, Neumayer and McMurdo, but there were hardly any observations in the East Antarctic, or the eastern side of Antarctica. McMurdo is officially in the East Antarctic, but it's very close to the West Antarctic itself. But in East Antarctic, there were very few observations. So what we did was we ended up making observations at our two Indian bases, which are Maitri and Bharti. And what we see is, first of all, I should mention that we have not only made observations the boundary layer, at the surface, but we've actually got vertical profiles. This is really good, because this is essentially the first time that vertical profiles have been retrieved in Antarctica, and this can be very useful for validating models which use iodine chemistry. So this is a new tool in our hands, and hopefully we'll be able to really push ahead in terms of validation of models using this. And what you can see is the mixing ratios at Bharti and Maitri are much lower. We're talking about less than a ppt as compared to at Halley Bay. This is pretty interesting, because that means the sources are not uniform. And in such a place, having ununiform sources is a bit of a conundrum, because it's not as if we have anthropogenic sources over there. So you don't expect such strong heterogeneity that would cause such large changes. So what we have done now is, last year I had gone and I had installed an instrument over there, and that was kept there for a full year. So now we have a full year data set, so we should be able to recreate this annual cycle and see whether that is really the case all throughout the year at Maitri and Bharti. And this is interesting, because first of all, satellites made an attempt. This was Anya Schoenhardt, who from Bremen, who had done these retrievals for us. And basically what it shows is there is a bit of a difference in where you are in terms of how active halogen chemistry is in Antarctica. Why this is, we don't understand. And thankfully now we do have observations at Maitri and Bharti, which are really helping understand whether these satellite observations are correct or not. So in terms of satellite validation, this data set has been priceless in terms of getting understanding whether this was just an artifact in the satellite or whether this was really true. And once we have the year-long data set, I think this will be even better in terms of validation itself. So that's a paper which we have just submitted. In terms of what are the remaining questions in terms of iodine, first, again, I keep talking about this. We need to get our fluxes right. Everybody loves running models, but unless you are feeding the model with right things, you are not going to get the right answers. You know, the usual saying is garbage in, garbage out. And unless we get our fluxes right, we are never going to get this the impacts right in terms of both of these chemical species. And then there are certain questions in terms of process level. Why is the emission of iodine so different in certain parts of Antarctica as compared to other parts of Antarctica? Why is it so different in the Arctic? Because Arctic does not show very high levels of iodine chemistry. So why is it very different? I would love to go and put an instrument at the NCPOR base over there and keep it running, because I think that will give us a really good comparison between the Arctic, Antarctic, and also help with satellite validation over there also. And whether this kind of chemistry is affecting the stratosphere. There are certain signals that, yes, it does get into the stratosphere. Interestingly, one of the main sources of iodine getting into the stratosphere is the Indian monsoon period, yeah, where you have the anticyclone and things get injected up because of these very strong, very deep clouds and all. So basically, what we are going to try and do is make some observations, not just over here, but also try and quantify how much is getting through the monsoon circulation. So this is a pretty exciting study and directly relevant to what's happening at IITM. So I'm looking forward to that too. What's happening with ozone in terms of the stratosphere? Because, you know, once iodine gets into the stratosphere, things in the stratosphere are going to be affected. And the main effect it's going to have is going to be ozone itself. So ozone is a pretty interesting guess. We know a lot about it. Everybody knows about the ozone hole, which is being shown in the video over here. And we have like satellite data from I think it's about 30 years or 40 years now, that shows that this hole has been happening every single year. In terms of its changes, what has been happening is there is a small recovery. It's still not a huge recovery as much as we want. There is still depletion being seen. So it's not a done and dusted story. There is still ozone depletion that is happening, something that we need to keep an eye on, especially as some countries end up emitting gases that have been banned and end up affecting the stratospheric ozone. So this is something that we definitely need to keep an eye on, because this causes global effects. In fact, the only Nobel Prize that has been given for atmospheric sciences, aside from the IPCC prize, was for this ozone hole story, because we know the kind of impacts it can have on life on Earth, right? So we have to keep an eye on it. So what we did was, IMD had been making some observations which were not really analyzed until recently. So we when I was in Antarctica, we started looking at this, and Srivardhan helped a lot with this analysis. What we did was we decided to check whether the satellite observations, which everybody seems to be using nowadays, how accurate is it? Are they there is validation happening, but are they as accurate as people really think? So what we started doing was we compared the OMI satellite and this MLS satellite with the in-situ ozone sondes, which are obviously a lot more accurate because they are not remote sensing, but they are direct observations, right? And what we noticed was the seasonal cycle, it seems to capture pretty well, right? So the vertical profiles also through the MLS satellite as compared to the ozone sondes, the ozone sondes are on the top and MLS is on the bottom. You can see the annual cycle is good. You can see the blue parts in spring, which is the ozone depletion season, that has been captured fairly well. And then the slightly higher values during the other seasons, which is being captured well by the satellite itself. So that was very good news, that the satellite is capturing the depletion. However, the satellite seems to be overestimating the ozone, especially over Bharti station. Now, this is interesting because when we start talking about ozone layer improving or recovering, then we need to know whether how much it has recovered by. And this difference is pretty significant. We're talking about differences of 30% between the satellite and ozone sonde observation. So if we are going to use only the satellite to say that ozone has recovered, we are probably overestimating how much the recovery is. That's why we really need to keep this in mind. And in fact, we need to apply these correction factors to the satellite data to get it right. So this was a paper which we just got published in Polar Sciences, which was a nice comparison between this. And it showed that then what we did was, this was at Bharti. Then we said, is it the case everywhere in Antarctica? Before that, I should say at Bharti. The other thing what we also did was we checked whether this is happening all through the year or is it seasonally dependent. And what you can see is the bottom plot, so the bottom panel, shows that the largest difference where the ozone is not matching very well between the satellite and in-situ observations is during the springtime. Now, this is especially worrying because the springtime is when ozone depletion really happens. And that's when the satellite is overestimating it. So the recovery of ozone because of satellites seems to be being overestimated, especially in the springtime itself. So this was the paper we published. And then we thought that, is this happening only at Bharti? Because there's a lot of regional dependence depending on the vortex and how it is moving year to year, etc. And Bharti being a very coastal location, it's at the edge of the Antarctic polar vortex. So we really wanted to check whether this is happening all through the continent. And so we did the same kind of computation everywhere. And yeah, there are differences happening pretty much in all the stations itself. These are at different stations. The names of the stations are above the plots itself. And as you can see, of course, at Bharti, Maitri, these are the two Indian stations, there is a difference. But there is a significant difference even at other stations like McMurdo or Dumont, etc., which are spread all around Antarctica. So we really need to keep this in mind and do corrections in order to estimate the ozone recovery properly. And why does this matter? I mean, of course, ozone recovery matters in terms of life on Earth because it filters the UV radiation, but also it matters in terms of the radiative forcing. Remember, ozone is a radiatively active gas. So it's a greenhouse gas. And that because it is so concentrated in the stratosphere, it really changes the structure of the atmosphere, etc. And any impact on ozone is going to have impact on the entire atmospheric circulation. So we need to get these numbers right. And this is a nice little study that Srivardhan had done, which is a part of that paper itself. And we used the SBDART model to quantify the radiative impacts. And as you can see, the difference in between the satellite and in-situ is as much as like 3 watts per square meter in terms of at the altitude of about 40 kilometers or so. So this is pretty high in terms of getting the radiative forcing right also. So that's another reason why we need to definitely continue measuring this ozone. And indeed, this is happening all across the continent. There are pretty large differences which are being computed at every single station. So unless we get this right, we know our model radiative forcing is not going to be very accurate either. So this is something that we know how to correct, and we will be getting in touch with the people who have the satellites, and we are quantifying on how to do the correction all across the ocean. With that, I'm going to come to a stop because I've spoken basically about 3 trace gases. There is a lot more that we have done in terms of reactive trace gases, but for now, I'm just going to focus on the open ocean and Antarctica. The take-home message from this talk is, first, we need to get our emissions right. The only way to get our emissions right is we need observations, because honestly, we have seen, at least all of our work shows, that we are using models and we are producing these results all the time, but we know that the models have shortcomings, and those shortcomings, the uncertainties are pretty large in certain cases. Very recently, along with Susan Krista, Bridget Huey, and myself, we've put together a paper which is being submitted to ACP. Hopefully, it should come out soon. And this is a very exciting paper because it's after a very long time, we've come up with a review on the atmospheric and gas phase composition over the Indian Ocean. And I know this is a very large paragraph, but I think it is very important for people to know this, because basically our understanding of the Indian Ocean, and in fact even the Southern Ocean, is based on very few sporadic ship-based campaigns. Even if plots look great when you put all the data, you have to remember that it's one single data point through the entire year on one single cruise track. So we have very little data in these parts of the atmosphere. So, you know, because of that, we don't understand what's happening in individual ocean basins. We don't understand the variations in terms of latitudes. We don't understand the vertical distributions, long-term changes. I mean, these are big, big questions which are still there. The main reason for this is just we haven't been making observations recently. We desperately need a long-term measurement site. All across the world now, they have set things up over the last 30, 40, 50 years or so. In the Atlantic, you have the Cape Verde Atmospheric Observatory. In Pacific, you have Mauna Loa. In the Southern Ocean, you have Point Benedict, etc. Indian Ocean, we don't have anything. This is a major gap, and I think as you know, not just IITM, but you know, the Indian scientists, we really need to address this point, because what's happening in the Indian Ocean is affecting things in India. It's not as if we are disconnected, and not just physically, but as you have shown, chemically also. It is very important. One of the main issues when we were writing this paper was we really did not have a database. Unfortunately, we have lots of people who hold on to their data and don't share it very quickly, especially because, you know, these are very rare campaigns. We really need to create a database for the Indian Ocean, like has been done for the Pacific or the Atlantic and all. And I think as a community, we need to come together and address these questions. With that, I will stop this talk, and I'll be happy to answer any questions. Thank you. Okay, thank you. So Vinu, should I just start answering questions that are on the chat window first? Partha?
Yeah, I think Vinu has already put the questions.
Yes.
I can start answering one by one.
Okay. All right. The first one is Rituparna Sarkar. She's asking, can you explain why at the end, why in climate scale the chemistry is the driving force? Okay, so why is chemistry the driving force on a climatic scale as compared to the physics? It's mainly because chemistry affects your radiative forcing, right? So the, you know, CO2, it's a chemical compound, but that is what is causing climate change, because it's a long-term greenhouse gas. So mainly chemistry changes the physics, and that's why it's the driving force behind climatic changes. The physics is the manifestation of the changes in chemistry, is how I would interpret it. And that's why it is the main driving force. Krishnan sir is asking, the magnitude of RF due to DMS over the Southern Ocean is much larger in DGF compared to JJA. How can we understand this? The main reason for this is because DGF is summer in the Southern Hemisphere, and DMS is a biologically active gas. So basically phytoplankton are creating it, and there's more biology during the summer because of more solar radiation. That's the claw hypothesis that I was talking about. The radiation controls the biology. So if you have more plankton, you end up getting a lot more emissions of DMS. So because of the emissions are much larger, there would be a larger impact on radiative forcing. During JJA, obviously, there's not as much solar radiation in the Southern Hemisphere because it's the Northern Hemispheric summer, and hence there's very little emission of DMS itself. Yogesh is asking whether OH plays any role in ozone iodine chemistry. OH Institute observations are available in India or anywhere in the world. This has been a long-term plan of mine, and you know, everybody who knows me in IITM at least knows that I've been asking for this one single instrument for the last 5-6 years. And the idea is to make OH observations. There are no OH observations anywhere in India. This is a major shortcoming. We are one of the few countries which we have not been able to do this as yet, because it's not been a priority area. But we know it's important. We need to have this right to get to know whether our models are working well or not. In terms of global observations, yes, there are observations, very strong groups in the UK, US, Sweden, Spain, etc. They are making observations of OH. Even in China, there are quite a few groups who are now making observations of OH. Does it play a role in ozone iodine chemistry? Yes, because OH does react with iodine also, and it helps in recycling iodine. So yes, it would definitely play a role. So getting the OH right is imperative if you want to get your ozone right. There's no doubt about it. Partha is asking, are these chemical species being assimilated in any other global reanalysis to improve the Southern Ocean processes, particularly clouds, as you mentioned, and DMS? So most of the models, as I understand, they do not have online chemistry, right? They do have the effect of DMS is through aerosols. So what they do have is sulfate aerosols in the model itself. Of course, these sulfate aerosols are generated in models which use DMS emissions. So they do have it, but it's not right. It's not as right as it needs to be, is the answer I would give. But it's not as if they do not have it. That's why you're not off by 20 watts per square meter. Otherwise, the global models would never be accurate, right? I mean, they would be wildly off. They are closer to the answer, but they are not on the answers yet. That's what we are trying to improve. And can we please throw some light on how the DMS production by marine plankton play a role in emissions from the oceans and how important that thing is? Yeah, so I'm not a biologist. So in terms of answering that question, I'm not the right person. What I will say is it's a hugely important role. DMS is produced by phytoplankton, not as something that they need, but it's a byproduct and eventually it comes out. Hence, it gets supersaturated in the ocean and then gets emitted upwards. The question is, why do they produce it? How much do they produce? Which plankton produce how much? And whether there is only emission, which we know there isn't, because you know the bacteria also consume it. It's their sulfur source, for example, or it also undergoes photolysis within the seawater. So there are losses in the seawater itself. So the entire cycle, including the biological cycle in the water itself, is a huge topic of research. There are hundreds and thousands of papers which have been written and are being written on this. It's not a very simple answer. It is a very complex cycle, biogeochemical cycle itself, and it is very important. I would definitely say how important it is. It is pretty critical. Krishnan sir also said it may be related to biological processes, photosynthesis, which is strong during the southern hemisphere summer. Yes, that's correct. That was the answer to the first question. And so you answered yourselves. Okay, I think that's all the questions we have. Vinu, is there, or Pada, anything else I need to answer?
I think that you have answered most of it. And it was one question remains. Let me put it to you.
Wait. Sure.
Yeah.
Okay, so Bell Creation is asking, has sulfur hexafluoride have the highest GWP? Okay, so sulfur hexafluoride, does it have higher global warming potential than CFCs? It does than some CFCs. Actually, I think lots of people tend to say that it is the highest the gas with the highest global warming potential. So it's definitely high up there. I'm not entirely sure whether it's the highest anymore, because there are certain other CFCs which have been invented, which are pretty large in terms of global warming potential. But it does have very, very high global warming potential. Yes.
Yes, so that's it. That's all of the questions we got. Dr. Partho may conclude the session.
Yeah, so Anup, it was an excellent talk. You know, even though I am nowhere near even C for chemistry, I understood a lot. It generated a lot of interest. I will start reading your papers and also related papers. I think the training will be same for the students as well. We are too much obsessed with the forecasting, but this is an area which, you know, we all should combinedly look from all aspects.
That's right. Excellent.
Yeah. Many thanks. Okay. Thank you for educating us. And thank you.
Thank you for having me on this platform. It was a pleasure.
Thank you.
Thank you. Goodbye.
Take care. Yeah, bye.